Richard is here to kick off our conference with a provocative, he's promised that it's going to be provocative, so expect your reaction, a provocative analysis of why and how Australia's official aid program needs to evolve. Please make Richard very welcome.
Just doing a little bit of a search for the clicker, and while we find it, I'll get started in any case. As I was struggling with putting together a presentation for today, I read that Leonard Cohen had taken 5 years to write the Hallelujah, and suddenly I felt a lot better. This presentation didn't take 5 years, and it's not the Hallelujah. It's called A Farewell to Arms, because the theme of it is that we have to change the charity designation that the program has in the Australian community. But again, as I was writing it, I read of a New Zealand physics professor who put together a conference proposal using an auto generator, and the proposal was accepted, and I thought maybe that's what I should have done with this. But you may think the same by the end of it. The slide changer, but it's not working. All right. I'm going to try and just show you the structure of the presentation, and advise you that. Bit of a difference between the way I wanted to get to this and the way I've been asked to. I've been asked particularly to focus on the sixth item, which is ideas for a more effective program. Now, that's on the basis that I've been told you guys have been doing so much thinking about all of this that your heads are in entirely the right place, and I don't need to rehearse much. Now, I accept that that's true, but I do think we've got an enormous job of work to do still, convincing the Parliament, the public, and the bureaucracy that the world is a very different place, and that requires not just a bit of tinkering, but some very, very major changes. There's a 25-page version of what I'm going to say, and that's on the record. I won't read it, and I suspect neither will you, but it's there. My views are formed by my experiences over quite a long time. Working in bilateral aid, multilateral aid, as a consultant, and particularly in recent times, working for developing countries themselves. And our failure to put ourselves into their shoes blinds us to what is happening and keeps us stuck in the past. And I think there is a significant need for change, but also major possibilities if we can persuade ourselves to be brave. I've spent decades defending aid, and I'm still very happy to do that. But today, I want to argue for fundamental change. Climate change, people movement, economic volatility, and destabilizing inequality represent the globalization of development problems. Western countries now confront these issues in ways that they never have before. But despite their wealth, richer countries cannot just go to the shelf for an answer, not for themselves and not for others. Whether we realize it, we're all developing countries now. And this changes everything. It breaks the fundamental logic of aid as a flow of resources, technology, ideas, solutions from developed, who've got it all sorted, to developing, who have nothing to offer. That equation no longer works, and we better get our heads around it. The institutions, the organizing principles, the culture of official aid are not built for this world. And we've got some changing to do. That process of reinvention is going to be difficult. For NGOs, of course, Uber aid's already arrived. disruption is here. You've had to contend with it already. So I think you are literally already a bit ahead of the game, but there's so much happening. I don't know that you'll stay there for very long unless you're extremely active. We know there's been an explosion in the number of alternative providers of money and ideas for development. We know that AIDS key clients group, if you think of it in terms of countries, poor, low capacity countries, shrunk dramatically. We know that poverty is shape-shifting, it's more urban, it's more to be found in middle-income countries, and again, a lot of our traditional ways of working do not allow for that. For 50 years, traditional aid organisations have been able to write the rules and largely avoid changing them. But power has shifted dramatically, and that changes the nature of the relationship. Our traditional aid products are much less valuable than they used to be, but their relative cost has actually gone up. All the things that we know are problems with the business, and we try to ameliorate. Those problems are much, much worse now, and for developing countries, the deal is increasingly unappealing. So we've got to get the heart of the systemic problems and change the business. I'll make some suggestions later about just a few ideas about what that might mean in the Australian context. But first, I really want to revisit two big changes that I don't think are adequately understood. One is that while development and humanitarian problems have been globalised, governance has not. And I think this is the underlying cause of massive frustration in electorates around the world. A clear majority of Australians, they want greater and more urgent action on climate change. Our parliament can't deliver it, nor can we reach wide community agreement on exactly what is required. And that's only one case. We know that conflict is displacing millions and millions of people, but humanitarian action has become the proxy for the political and indeed the security action to prevent conflict and its implications. For more than 30 years, international and domestic institutions have driven freer trade and investment and made most of us better off in the process, and certainly a transfer of wealth from the developed world to the developing world. But, of course, not everybody is a winner. And inattention to the distributional and political consequences of globalization threatens the entire enterprise. Now, I think citizens understand these things seemingly better than their leaders. And that they're getting cranky because the big stuff is just not getting sorted. So remaking national, regional, and global governance and making it more inclusive, more genuinely democratic, decentralized, this, to me, has got to be very, very high on the development agenda. And it doesn't just mean working with developing countries. It means working in our own communities and with other so-called developed countries as well. Different game. The second really big point that I don't think is well appreciated, particularly for official agencies, is that the diseconomies of administrative scale are growing. While the delivery of Australian assistance has always been decentralised, and so we use international bodies, community groups, private contractors, management is incredibly highly centralised. To me, the best analogy is that aid is a state-owned enterprise, and it's responsive mainly to its government owners, and it looks the way it does all across the Western world because that's the fundamental relationship, and that's where everybody looks. They look up to their government owners. They don't look across so much to the real customer. And as a state-owned enterprise, it's dominated by planning tools, multiple layers of management, and all of that's designed to reduce risk, designed to reduce obvious failure. It's not designed to maximize success. In 2013, AusAid had more than 1,000 pages of guidance for staff. We had 140 management tools and instruments and 1,200 management processes. We were managing 5,000 separate agreements across 25 policy lines. Now, we could talk at another time about why that is, but I think it's because that's the way governments want it. but you cannot deliver impact in that way. And our customers know that, and they're telling us that. If the bottom line were aid effectiveness, we would do less, we'd be much more focused, and we would buy in real expertise in order to increase the value of our products. And indeed, if we want more diplomatic impact as well, we'd be doing the same things. There isn't a fundamental contradiction here because the market has changed. Former World Bank President Jim Adams observed at ANU last year, traditional aid is surprisingly weak at some of its core business, capacity building. Really, if we haven't got this worked out after 50 years, there's something wrong, and there is something wrong. Almost nobody is getting this right. And I agree with Jim, but I don't think it's so surprising. It's because we're not sufficiently client-focused. Instead of recognising the fundamental problems, I think the Western Aid Club, led by the DAC, has added to these problems. It's made aid more and more complicated and increasingly unattractive to the countries that are the consumers of it. Last year, I returned to Myanmar to undertake a review of aid coordination, following a stint working inside the ministry in 2012-13. All of the old problems are still there. Fragmented, supply-driven assistance. We said we were going to get it right this time. We're not. It looks very, very similar. Pushy aid providers, all working separately. Last year, 5,000 separate training workshops, events and launches. And guess who has to cope with all of that? The country itself. We overwhelm our partners, we disenfranchise them, and particularly when we're trying to be most helpful. If we don't fix these problems, I think there's a pretty limited future for what we're offering, or if we do keep on offering it decade in, decade out, it's actually not going to be seen by our partners as very valuable. Now, in changing the situation, I think we've got a real problem. The problem is that in Australia, our perceptions of what this business is about are incredibly narrow, shallow, and they hold us back from taking it seriously. Australia is, as a consequence, not well positioned to respond to disruption. Peter Varghese, the former DFAT secretary who inherited the aid program, conceded in frank and constructive comments earlier this year that pre-integration he had very strong views about aid, but they weren't necessarily always well informed. I thought that was a really useful contribution to us thinking about where aid and development sit in the scheme of things. But he wasn't alone in having to make that concession. I attended set of estimates for 8 years between 2000 and 2013. And quite frankly, during that entire time, I think there was only one member of the committee who consistently was well prepared, inquiring, constructive, and thorough. That is my experience, Maurice Payne. And I'm delighted she's the defence minister now, but I think that's pretty tragic. We're a wealthy, successful trading nation in a region of developing countries, but actually we don't seem to think that there's much value on focusing on international development issues. Now, this to me is a great paradox, and I think we've allowed that paradox to develop. I think there's all sorts of reasons, but I think civil society needs to challenge this much, much more strongly. We've allowed aid to be, development rather, to be bundled with aid to be labelled as charity, and this renders it of very little interest to the policy community. I think some of the things also that we've done more actively is too much of our own marketing still remains click-based, charity-focused reinforcement of helplessness and dependency. We've got better, but I think there's still far too much of that, and far too much of our time, the vast majority of it, is taken up lobbying government about aid volume. Well, guys, as soon as when we do that incessantly, day in, day out, we don't leave space for other stuff, and we're not taken seriously as a result. We have to deepen the conversation. We've chosen the lowest common denominator, and we've marginalised ourselves in the process. I think the development community has shrunk, not in numbers, but in vision and impact. I think we're fragmented now into a myriad of agencies. We're spruiking bespoke products in a quest for increased market share, chasing grants, providing services. The collective action, and particularly the policy-based collective action, has been pushed to the side. We are deluding ourselves if we believe that by corporatising, maximising our fundraising, and just being more efficient and effective at delivering aid projects, that we maximise our impact. When it comes to the really big development issues, trade, conflict, people movement, climate change, largely we've left the field to foreign affairs analysts, economists, professional commentators whose frames of reference are incomplete. We've got to get in there, we've got to understand the language and the concepts of these other groups, talk to them in their language and convince them that we've got value to add. Our allergy to discussing national interest has removed our ability to shape it. If integration is going to work, civil society must be a big part of the conversation. When I was a DDG for OZA, I was incredibly surprised. With two exceptions, nobody ever came to talk to me. Maybe there was all sorts of other reasons for that, but I expected to be lobbied quite a lot. People to want to have conversations about policy. It didn't happen. I think we have to be much more active with the parliament, much more active with the bureaucracy, and across the spectrum of policy, not just limited to the aid people in DFAT. There's another problem that we have too, which is very deep. I think we're ambivalent about where we live. Too much of our focus is elsewhere. Despite the region's dynamism and its contribution to our prosperity, we look to our great and powerful friends, and that causes us to focus too much on London and Washington, and consequently too much on the Middle East and Central Asia. We've got to get back to this part of the world for all sorts of reasons, not least because there's a bit going on the diplomatic and security side as well. And it's a full-time occupation for Australia, or it ought to be. And we need to change that. Individuals understand this, but as a polity, we do not understand where we live. I've got a number of proposals for change aimed at responding to some of this, but they're just a few ideas. You'll have a whole lot more. There's some common themes in the proposals I'm going to put forward. One is we must narrow the focus to be more effective. Do less. Less geography, fewer sectors, less activities. Get real, focus, and be more effective. To complement that, we've got to be building knowledge and expertise. This is a knowledge business. And if we are not at the top of our game, if we're not ahead of the game, we've got nothing to offer. So we need deep, deep expertise. And the hard one, we need to totally overhaul those management processes. That whole management model that I talked about, it's all command and control, highly centralized, multi-layered, very inefficient. It's got to go. The first thing that I would do is to say, look, what a wonderful opportunity that we've got to improve our diplomacy as well as our development work. Bring them both together in a way that changes and improves the two. Pivot back to where we live. Take a longer-term perspective about what our interests are. They're not just transactional, they're not just trade, important as those things are. It is the development of the region that ultimately delivers the biggest benefits or entails the biggest risks for Australia. We can build deeper and wider linkages if we focus here. We are absolutely kidding ourselves that we can focus intensively all over the world. We certainly have global interests as well as regional interests, but we've got to work differently. The intensity has to be right here. In order to do this, what we need to be doing, I think the first order of business is we need a comprehensive development policy. We haven't had one from government, and it is needed so that we all understand what the vision is. For my money, I think we need to make this more compelling in a community sense. We've got to connect or reconnect citizens to the globe. There's an understandable pulling back at the moment. We've got to find very powerful arguments why we need to be connected to the globe. The program needs to be an expression of who we are, where we're going, what we value. I think it should deliberately reject charity status. We should talk about national interest, but we should define national interest differently. We should define it as in our interest to be projecting our values, equity, justice, shared responsibility. As you know, the vast majority of partners are exiting Asia, and they're concentrating increasingly on poor countries elsewhere. I don't think we should do that. We've still got over a billion people under $2 a day in Asia, so we've got serious work to do. And as I said at the start, development's not so linear anymore. It's not just a case of helping countries increase a bit of growth and that's the job. It's all interrelated. So actually, we've got to be working very intensively with countries in the region, lower middle income countries, but even countries like Singapore, Malaysia, China, difficult as it is, they've all got pretty big stakes in development, and we need to be working with them on policy and practice. As you know, the region's got 4.5 billion people. It's been humming along most of the time at about 7% growth. It's the engine of the world. So, for my money, we can do the best by the globe as a whole by underpinning development in Asia, because other parts of the world are benefiting tremendously from the additional development in this region. It also gives us a better division of labour. With everybody crowding in with their flags and their separate programs and tripping over each other's feet in other places, if we stay the course here, it'll be much easier for us to be valuable, and we can really build some international global skill on middle-income countries, and of course on the Pacific, where we do need to do things differently. One of the things we need to do differently is stop over-relying on aid. It's time for some serious diplomatic heavy lifting in the Pacific. Many of the microstates are not going to be viable unless we renegotiate the economic relationship with Australia and New Zealand and the rest of the region. We tackle labour rights, we tackle fisheries and ocean rights, and we help countries put together long-term economic agreements. Of course, we'll still have to help many of the smaller countries keep the lights on, but that shouldn't blind us from the other things we need to be doing. The last one here is probably going to be a bit controversial. I do think that we need to go big. We need to be going into very, very big programs that are highly visible, and they should be built around shared interests. Problems of the commons that we need to sort out together, and I think there's a whole variety of possibilities there, clearly around environmental issues, but also urban development, international health. There's a whole set of possibilities. But if we concentrate on shared interests, I think that will make it very much easier to sell it to the Australian community. So not sharing in some narrow mercantilist sense, but genuinely where the development of the region impinges on us and vice versa. Second, it's time for the aid language to go. And if you work in developing countries, I mean really inside them, you will know how much people hate this language and how destructive it is. I know some people think this is politically too politically correct to say this, but actually words matter. And as soon as developing country partners hear aid, they just say, there they go again. And they expect all the patronising baggage that comes with it. I would retire the whole foreign aid brand. I don't think it works anymore, including in the Australian community. There's maybe a quarter of the population that are pretty positive, and I think probably twice that are pretty negative. I think the time's come to get rid of it. But the really important thing is not just a change of words. It's a change of practice. And I said at the beginning, essentially we're self-referenced, we do things our own way, then you know we've got to put the countries in the driver's seat, we've got to let them take control. That means joint action from everything, from planning all the way through to evaluation. Joint work. In order to make a big change, I think we need to move to wholesale partnering. So this is a big management change where essentially we'd be investing a lot more trust in our partnerships, both commercial, multilateral, and community groups. I'm going to have to move along pretty fast. In order to make that sort of change, which is an enormous change in the way we work, I actually think we need to have a separate agency. I don't think DFAT can pull this off. Integration is a great idea, and at a policy level, it should be maintained. I think the scope for a small technical agency, something like GIZ Lite, that is allowed to do some deep thinking about some of these practical management issues, and we can concentrate some real expertise in there. Brand new capacity building models are required that put developing countries and communities in the driver's seat, fully integrated, and with us having to, you know, play a much more of a supporting role. On multilateralism, the system is broken. It's very, very hard to fix. Nothing's worked to date. My solution would be to say, look, we've got an awful lot of new machinery to build. We better get on and do that. We won't be able to do that if we stick with what we've got, but we're not able to change it alone. Invert that. Start from a clean sheet of paper, decide what is absolutely essential to fund that, and I'm afraid walk away from the rest in order to have the time and the money to build the new machinery that needs to be built. I think we could set up an Australian fund for international development into which the budget would go, and then those budget monies would be preserved. I think then that money could carry over from year to year. We could reduce the spending driver and the uncertainty and the trying to balance the books annually, and that would be quite a significant improvement in the business. And lastly, I'd move the Office of Development Cooperation to PM&C. It's a small change, but I think it would be very useful. Give them a bit more independence, link them up with the other sort of strategic elements of Prime Minister and Cabinet, and allow them to do some big picture development thinking. I'm going to skip these other points and just come to my last point. So there's some other ideas in there about how we proceed. On the white paper, I'd say this. I'm a little bit nervous. White paper is a great opportunity for us to recognise the importance of development and to begin to integrate it. I think it would be foolish to try to rush that and do it all in the white paper. I think it'll get a bit lost. And so I'm suggesting we should have a separate process, and one of our jobs should be to work out what that is. Not a conventional review, something involving bigger picture thinking. The last few comments I want to make quickly are in regard to what I'm calling the night shift. And it goes back to that my beginning points about governance. I think our existing institutions are struggling, and they risk being overwhelmed. I don't think citizens yet are willing to concede that the solutions have to be global, that they are in a position where they're tending to become more insular, and we need to argue the case. We've got a rising tide of protectionism, it's building internationally. If that really sets in, beggar thy neighbour policies, we saw what happened in the 1930s, they have the potential to make us all not only much poorer, but much more insecure. So I think we've got to bring our insights into the conversation. I'm encouraged by the fact that Malcolm Turnbull has been putting forward a shared development vision. He started several domestic speeches locating Australia in this region. I think we should rise to that and pick that up and run with it, because it's really very, very powerful. But we need a new development activism that critiques the world in which we live. By activism, I don't mean a campaign against government, nor an Occupy DFAT movement, but rather constructive, evidence-based engagement with opinion leaders. 60s and 70s activism was largely about smashing things, often that needed to be smashed. Now we need to build. We need people all over town meeting in pubs and clubs, supermarkets, school, Facebook, Twitter, plotting how to save government, often from itself. And I know that building the centre sounds very anodyne until you realise that without it, little can get done. And I'm with Noel Pearson on this. Without greater consensus, we are facing a night shift, a descent into darkness. To prevent it, I think we're all going to have to work the night shift to link international and domestic development and move them to centre stage. So this is a farewell to arms and a call to arms. Thank you.
Provocative, bold, get us thinking very early in the piece. They come from a very informed point of view, and what I liked about your presentation was not only did you make the provocation, but you offered solutions. And often people will come to a conference and just throw out the problem, but you've offered a suite of solutions that come from your own, not your own knowledge in the sector, and we should pay very close attention, I think, to Richard's very strong provocation. We will be talking with Richard and the panel after lunch at a Q&A, so you'll get a chance to ask your questions. And I think you'll probably be inundated with questions and responses over the lunch break. But I thought that was a remarkable, very, very broad sweep across the landscape we're dealing with, and the provocations we should take very seriously. Could you thank Richard again for that presentation?